Hi, we're the Atkinsons, and we're thankful for
the love that we have for one another. We're thankful for our loving family, and we're thankful for
our health and strength, and our church family, our extended family, and
the love that Jesus continued to place upon us each and every day.
Yes, that's right. Happy Thanksgiving.
Good morning, Second Baptist Church family. I'm Steve.
And I'm Keisha Darden.
And we're here to tell you what we are thankful for this season. Amen. The Word of God says in 1 Thessalonians 5:16-18, rejoice always, pray without ceasing, and in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you.
We are so blessed and thankful for new beginnings, for our new marriage, for our relationship with one another, and for our relationship with Christ. I am so thankful to have a husband that I can pray with and talk to about anything. I give all glory and praise to God for this man of God that he has brought into my life. I'm thankful for our family, our children, and we are especially thankful for our grandchildren.
Noah Ray Carter,
Kaylee and Kamari.
Yes, we are so thankful that we get to spoil them, love on them, and then send them back to their parents. Amen. What a pleasure it is to be grandparents.
Amen. We are especially thankful for our Second Baptist Church family and for our pastor, Pastor Chris, for ministering to us, for praying with us, amen, and for just being there for us.
Amen.
And thankful for the opportunity to come and share what we're thankful for.
Amen. God bless you and keep you. We love you. We'll see you.
Bye.
Good evening. Welcome to another Wednesday in the Word. I trust and pray that you and your family are well, that you are blessed, that you are experiencing all of the love, the joy, the grace, the peace of God, our Father. Listen, God is great and He is greatly to be praised. I am so excited that we can come into your homes, into your offices, to your automobiles, you lounging by the pool, wherever you may be, to declare that Jesus is Lord to the glory of God. I'm so thankful that you are tuning in, near or far, with us at this historical Second Baptist Church of Monrovia. We are so glad that God has divinely saw fit for us to worship together and to go through the Word of God together. So thank you so very much for tuning in. Now, listen, we have been in a series talking about the importance of praise. I certainly pray and hope that you are experiencing more vigor in your praise, that you are understanding the importance of praise and how God dwells among the praises of His people. And listen, child of God, you are a child of God. And when you praise Him, I believe God dwells, He comes down, He inhabits among the praises of His sons and His daughters. So let's keep praising God. How about that? Tonight, I want to kind of pick up a little bit of where we left off on Sunday. This past Sunday, we started something that God has impressed upon my heart to talk about the importance of our words, our mouths. We kind of umbrella this series, if you will, of Lord, help me manage my mouth. We want to talk a little bit more about that and dive deeper into this subject matter. So I want you to get your Bibles. I want you to get your smart devices. I want you to get your notepads. And let's just fireside chat. Let's talk. Let's look at some scripture And more importantly, let's see what the Holy Spirit has to say to each and every one of us about the importance of our words. So while you're getting those things, I want you to bow with me as we ask God's blessings on our time. Will you pray with me? Father, it is in you that we live, we move, and we have our very being. And we thank you so very much for blessing us to come through this day up into this very present moment. Father, as we come into your presence, we acknowledge our sins and our transgressions, and we pray and ask that you will please forgive us for every one of them, those in thought, those in deed, and yes, Lord, those that we have even spoken in word. We pray, God, that you will bless our time tonight. I pray, God, that you will encourage my brother and sister. I pray that you will challenge us, Father God, in your word, Lord, and help us to bring about the change that we need so that you can be glorified and those around us will be edified. So we thank you. We pray tonight that healing will take place, God, that direction would be given, Father, that hearts will be mended, that heads would be uplifted, Father, through the power of your word. So use us for your glory, and I declare the blessings of the Lord over us even now. And we do this in Jesus Christ our Lord. Thank God, and amen and amen. All right, let's jump into this time tonight. And we want to jump in by using a foundational scripture. This foundational scripture is one that you've probably spoken or heard several times, but we shared a little bit about it on Sunday, and that is in Proverbs. Proverbs chapter 18, verse number 21. Proverbs chapter 18, verse number 21. Let's kind of use this as one of our foundational scriptures that will help us during this time so that we know the importance of our words. Here we go. Proverbs chapter 18, verse number 21. Here's what the word of the Lord says. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit. Can you say amen? So once again, death and life are in the power of the tongue. More importantly, death and life are in the power of your tongue. So here is the question to start off this study is, are your words bringing about more life, or are your words bringing about more death? Let that marinate. The words that you speak, when you speak to others, when you speak to your spouse, when you speak to your children, when you speak to your coworkers, when you speak to your neighbors, when you speak to the saints of God, when people hear you speak, are the words that you use more about bringing life? Are they enhancing? Are they encouraging? Are they beneficial? Or are they bringing about death? Are they, people don't want to hear you talk because every time you talk, it's something negative. If they hear you talk, they may think, listen here, I feel drained after I hear this person. So answer that question. You don't have to raise your hand, but do the words that you speak bring about life, or do they bring about death? Our words are powerful, and it is so important for us to know that we have a responsibility as sons and daughters of God to make sure that we speak words that are edifying to the saints of God, edifying to our neighbors, edifying to our family, our children. The words that we speak to them, listen, can bring about greatness, or for some, it can bring about sadness, because you have their ear, and the words that you speak, listen, according to the word of God, they bring about death and they bring about life. Are you still with me? So that's our foundational scripture. So what is it that we are to do? When we think about our words and when we think about things that happen in our lives, many of us can find ourselves having you know, a different type of tongue, if you will. The Bible is filled with things that are said and where these tongues originate, if you will. And many times it's based on, if we take a moment of reflection and a moment of just thinking about things that we've said, sometimes I think we'll probably get to a place where we'll say, man, I can't believe I said that. Did I really say those words? Did I really say what came out of my mouth? I mean, because truthfully, as sons and daughters of God, we really, as true sons and daughters of God, we have the DNA of our Father. And the DNA of God, our Father, is not to speak light, speak death and to just put people down. But listen, the Word of God, we find God's Word encouraging, lifting, building. God wants to forgive. He wants to heal. He wants us to live, in the words of some, our very best life. And living our best life requires us to use our best words. But there are some types of tongues that we need to look at that some of us deal with. Let's go over to the book of James. James chapter number 3. And this will be another kind of foundational scripture that we jump off of. James chapter 3. Now, I'm not going to dissect this too much right now, but I want to use this also to help us as we kind of navigate through this time. Here we go. James chapter 3. And let's begin at verse number 1. Here we go. My brethren, let not many of you become teachers, knowing that we will receive it stricter judgment. I'm sorry, let me read it again. My brethren, let not many of you become teachers, knowing that we shall receive a stricter judgment. Here we go. For we all stumble in many things. If anyone does not stumble in word, he is a perfect man, able to bridle his whole body. Indeed, we put bits in horses' mouths that they may obey us, and we turn their whole body. Look also at ships. Although they are so large and are driven by fierce winds, they are turned by a very small rudder wherever the pilot desires. Even so, the tongue is a little member and boasts great things. See how great a forest a little fire kindles. And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. The tongue is so set among our members that it defiles the whole body and sets on fire the course of nature. And it is set on fire by hell. For every kind of beast and bird, of reptile and creature and of the sea is tamed and has been tamed by mankind. Here we go, verse 8. But no man can tame the tongue, for it is an unruly evil full of deadly poison. With it we bless our God and Father, and with it we curse men who have been made in the similitude of God. Out of the same mouth proceed blessing and cursing. My brethren, my sisterin, these things ought not to be so. Can you say amen? All right, now, listen. James laid it out there, and James was talking about how we have all of these animals. They're able to be tamed. When we look at lions and tigers and bears and all of these different animals, man is able to tame these animals. But the challenge of man is to tame his and her tongue. Why is it such a challenge to tame our tongue? Why is it such a challenge to tame the words that come from our mouth? Could it be because our words really come from our emotions? Could it be that many times, somebody used to say, I'll lay down my religion so I can say certain things. Could it be that we just want to get what's off our mind out of our mouth so that somebody else could hear it? Could it be that we want to get what's off our chest? We really want people to feel some kind of way. We want them to feel pain. We want them to feel like they can't say this or that about us. So we verbalize it. And the scripture lets us know that you and I, listen, this tame is a deadly poison. This tongue is, it's deadly. It can cause a fire. This tongue, according to Proverbs chapter 18, can cause death and it can cause life. Are you still there? So here is what we do, and then we're gonna get a little deeper. Is we go back to what Psalm 141 and stanza 3 says. Y'all remember what Psalm 141? Because this is what somebody needs to know now. We gotta ask God, Lord, if I can't do it on my own, how can I tame my tongue? And remember, that's what we pray and we ask the Lord in Psalm 141, stanza 3. Lord, set a guard over my mouth. Keep watch over the doors of my lips. Child of God, we have to ask God to help us. Ask God to get the evil, yeah, get the hate, get the bitterness, get the pain out of our heart, because those words come out of our mouth. So I'm jumping ahead of myself. All right. So let's talk about a few types of tongues. These are a few types of tongues that some of us we struggle with. I was reading Dr. Deborah Pagay. She has a book called Taming the Tongue, and you know, it's very interesting read to kind of go in to this study. And a few types of tongues that the Bible speaks of that we have to work on and ask God to help us with are these types of tongues. The first one, the first tongue that we have to deal with is called the lying tongue. Yeah, the lying tongue. If you want to speak life and not death, you need to stop lying. Yet somebody needs to hear that, okay? The lying tongue. Go with me to Proverbs. Proverbs chapter 12, verse number 22. Proverbs chapter 12, verse number 22. Here we go. Proverbs 12, 22. Here's what it says. Lying lips are an abomination to the Lord. Yeah, that pretty much says it all. But look at the B clause. But those who deal truthfully are his delight. Can you say amen? Let me read that again because your neighbor interrupted you. Proverbs 12, 22 says, lying lips are an abomination to the Lord, but those who deal truthfully are his delight. Can you say amen? So here we have, ma'am and sir, the importance of making sure that we tell the truth. Can somebody say that? Just tell the truth. Now, when it comes to lying comes in several different forms. Did you know that? It's not just when I was growing up, some people would say, well, that's just a little white lie. That, you know, and then other lies are, you know, they call them all kinds of other things. But lies really are broken down into four areas. Let's deal with them. One of the first areas of lies that people tell are lies of deceitfulness. Yes, deceitfulness. When someone lies and they're deceiving you. Now deceitfulness is a form of trickery, and what it does is it takes a lie and it twists itself into making it appear okay. Deceitful lies is where somebody is deceitful with it and they try to twist it around to make it seem like what they're saying, which is an untruth, is okay. Now, deception occurs when we deceive people. We We deceive them. We lie. We lie to our bosses and tax accountants, and we lie to spouses. Children lie to parents. We deceive. But can I tell you something? One person that we cannot deceive is God. We cannot deceive God. So you and I, ma'am, you and I, sir, we must ask God to help us not to lie, but help us not to be deceptive in our words. Let's talk about another one. Another type of word that comes under the umbrella of lie is called half-truths. Have you ever met anybody that didn't tell the whole thing and they told half of it? And because they only told a certain half, they thought that they were getting away with telling the truth. Half-truths are lies, but they are partial truths. When you know, we do certain things, you know, and we know good and well that they are not so, but we get away, we think we get away with it because it's a half-truth. Child of God, that falls under the umbrella of lies. Another type of word that comes under the umbrella of lies is not only a deceitfulness, not only half-truths, but there's something called exaggerations. Have you ever met anybody who exaggerated so much until you just had to say, stop lying? I caught a fish this big. No, you didn't. It was a little guppy about like that. Folks will embellish the truth and they put a whole lot of stuff on things because they're trying to maybe make themselves look good, maybe to help feel better about themselves, but truthfully it's an exaggeration or it's a lie. And the fourth type of word that comes under the umbrella of lying is this word called flattery. Flattery. Flattery sometimes can be spoken when one is trying to impress one. You're trying to talk to someone and you're trying to be crafty with your words. You're trying to be smooth with your words and you know, you're flattering and you know, ladies, you have to be careful because, you know, some of these rascals will come up and they'll, you know, talk a smooth talk. Hey, you know, what's up, baby? How you doing? Y'all been there. You know, and fellas, you know, the same way, you know, some of these ladies will say, you know what, are those really your muscles? I mean, are you going to the gym? I mean, just, you know, goodwill, he ain't going to the gym. But anyway, we say these things and unfortunately these flattery words where we're trying to embellish the truth with words of exaggeration, half-truths, and even deceitfulness, they all fall under the umbrella of lies. And the Bible says in Proverbs chapter 12, verse 22, lying lips are an abomination to the Lord. You and I do not want to be an abomination to the Lord, so we've got to stop lying. Are you there? Because we want that second part of that verse. It says, but those who deal truthfully are his delight. I don't know about you, ma'am. I don't know about you, sir, but I want to be a delight to the Lord. And I've got to do that by telling the truth. Can you say amen? All right, let me roll to the next one. Another thing that we have to do is another type of tongue that we need to work on taming. And that's where we tame the lying tongue. We got to try to tame this tongue. Try to tame, here it is, a hasty tongue. Go to Proverbs 29 and 20. Proverbs 29 and 20. It deals with a hasty tongue. Here's what the word of the Lord says. Proverbs chapter 29, verse number 20. Do you see a man hasty in his words? There is more hope for a fool than for him. Wow, can you say amen? Look at that. That this is what the proverbial writer says. He says, do you see a man hasty in his words? There is more hope for a fool than for him. Let's work on that. What are hasty words, Pastor Chris? You're saying that there's more, there's you know, more hope for a fool than a man who uses, or a woman who uses, hasty words. The hasty tongue can get you in trouble because it's a tongue that speaks before you think. You're just blurting something out. It's a tongue that is just, you got to have a quick response, you know. Some people will call it, you try to be witty, you know, have that wit about you. But can I tell you something? You and I, sometimes it's not about being witty. It's not about being hasty, but it is about taking the time to think before you speak. Now, a hasty tongue is a tongue that, listen here, can be offensive. When we speak in haste, many times we can offend someone. And that may be because we're speaking, you know, so fast in responding to something, or so fast in saying something. Many times it can be offensive to someone. Our speech, when we speak in haste and offense, it can cause pain. It can cause distress. And can I tell you something? A hasty word can bring about negative responses in relationships. So we've got to ask God to help us tame the hasty tongue so that we're not offended. We also have to tame the hasty tongue so that we work on how we respond. Let me work on that a little bit. When we respond in haste, many times we're responding, you know, to what has been said or what has been done, many times to get back at the person that we're saying something about, or saying something to, rather. You know, someone said something, you know, that dress is not cute. And you might respond and say something back to them, and just responding in haste to get it off your chest because they said something that bruised your ego or hurt your feelings. So you got to get back and retaliate to them. And many times, unfortunately, when we respond in haste, we try to up one on them. We try to say something more hurtful than they said to us. So we've got to ask God, Lord, help us not to have a hasty tongue so that we're not offensive and so that we don't respond in haste. Are you still with me? I'll come back to that. But Lord, help us not to have a lying tongue. Lord, help us not to have a hasty tongue. Let me give you a couple more, and then I'm going to give you some homework to do. A third type of tongue that we've got to ask God to help us to tame is a tongue that is a divisive tongue. Yeah. Did you know that your tongue can bring about division among folks? Did you know that what you say, listen, can sometimes cause a group to have issues? It can cause a team to be dismantled by words, by the words that you speak. Proverbs chapter 6, verse number 19. Proverbs chapter 6, verse number 19. Let's work on that just a little bit. Proverbs 6 and verse 19. Listen at what the word of the Lord says regarding a divisive tongue. A false witness who speaks lies, and one who sows discord among brethren. As a matter of fact, let's backtrack. I want to go up a few verses. Let's read this passage, because it really speaks of six things that God hates. Go up to verse 16. I'm sorry. Proverbs chapter 6, verse 16. Here we go. These six things the Lord hates. Yes, seven are an abomination to him. First thing he hates is, here we go, verse 17. A proud look, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked plans, feet that are swift in running to evil. Here we go. A false witness who speaks lies, and one who sows discord among brethren. Can you say amen? Here we go, child of God. Within these things that God hates, He speaks of a lying tongue. He hands that shed innocent blood, all that. But he gets down to the last portion, and he talks about a false witness. And this false witness is one who speaks lies and one who, listen, sows discord, not among outsiders, not discord among just co-workers, but discord among the brethren, discord among the sisters, discord among the saints of God. Child of God, God hates that. And that is a divisive tongue. Can I tell you something? Unfortunately, there are people who deliberately use words to tear apart different things. They tear apart groups. They tear apart ministries. They tear apart churches. They do what they can by using a divisive tongue. Many times, those divisive tongues are lying tongues. They're saying things to make them look good and somebody else look bad. And child of God, you've got to be careful. If that's you, ma'am, if that's you, sir, and ask God to help you to tame that. As a matter of fact, you need to ask God to help you to be delivered from it, because God hates this. God hates this. He does not like discord sown among his children. Unfortunately, there are so many people who use this type of tongue, this divisive tongue. And when divisive tongues go forth, it tears apart families. You say, you're just like your daddy, you're just like your mama, you're this, that, and the other. And you listen, when you're saying things that are not uplifting, are not, you know, edifying, you're many times using words that will be words that will tear down, that will divide. Unfortunately, it happens. It happens in church, discord. It happens in homes. Marital relationships are messed up because somebody uses a divisive tongue, saying things that tear and hurt that spouse. It happens among children. It happens in relationships. So, child of God, listen, you and I have a responsibility as sons and daughters of God to not be the ones who are false witnesses who are sowing seed of discord. Can't do that. And you definitely don't want to do that among the brethren. Can you say amen to that? All right. So let me hold on right here, because I want to give you a quick homework assignment. I want to give you a quick homework assignment. I want you to also, in your time of study this week, when you're looking and having some time, I want you to look at something called a manipulative tongue. A tongue that's not just hasty, not divisive, but there's a tongue that can manipulate you. And your homework assignment is to read in the book of Judges, Judges chapter 16. It's a familiar passage to some of you, but I want you to take time and I want you to see how a manipulative tongue is not one that God is calling for you and I to have. And if you have been a manipulator, child of God, you've got to ask God to help you to tame that tongue. All right, so listen, so I've given you this tonight. So what can we do? How can we manage this? What are some tools or things we could do to help us get on track? I'm glad you asked that. I'm going to give you a couple more passages of scripture. I want you to go, first of all, to the book of Titus. All right, let's look at Titus. And Titus gives us kind of a springboard of patterns that we should look at. Titus is right after Timothy. And I want you to go to Titus chapter 2, and I want to read two verses, all right? Titus chapter 2, verses 7 and 8. One more time. Titus chapter 2, verses 7 and 8. Here goes the reading of the Word of God. In all things, showing yourself to be a pattern of good works, in doctrine, showing integrity, reverence, and incorruptibility. verse 8. Sound speech that cannot be condemned, that one who is an opponent may be ashamed, having nothing evil to say of you. Can you say amen? So here it is. So child of God, I want us, as we ask God to help us tame our tongues, is that we are to have a pattern. Let's show ourselves a pattern of good works by what we do. You know, we do things that show good works, but it's based on us having sound speech. We have good works and we also have good words. Does that make sense? So yes, many people can say, oh, I do this, I do that. Oh, I serve, I give, I do all of these things. Those are wonderful works. Now let's make sure our words line up with our works. So your assignment, you're going to read a little bit. You're going to read Judges chapter 16. You're going to talk a little bit, figure out manipulative tongue. And then you're also going to look and make sure that you have a pattern of good works and good words. Are you there? Let me give you one more passage of scripture that I want you to chew on. We're going to chew on this because the Holy Spirit was just showing this to me, and it kind of picks up where we skated on a little bit on Sunday. But I want you to go to Matthew, St. Matthew's Gospel chapter 12. All right. St. Matthew's Gospel chapter number 12. All right. And let's jump down to verse number 33. Matthew chapter 12. And I want you to jump down to verse number 33. All right. One more time, Matthew chapter 12, beginning at verse number 33. Here goes a reading of God's word. Either make the tree good and its fruit good, or else make the tree bad and its fruit bad. For a tree is known by its fruit. Now listen, just pause for a moment. That's a mouthful. A tree is known by its fruit. If you say you're a plum tree, then you should bear plums. If you say you're an apple tree and lemons are coming off of you, then somebody's wrong. Something is wrong. If you say you are a Christian, if you say you are a son of God, you say you are a daughter of God, then a tree should be known by its fruit. Are you still there? All right. Watch what else. The passage says, jump down to verse 34. Brood of vipers, how can you, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. We touched on that on Sunday. Verse 35. A good man, out of the good treasure of his heart, brings forth good things. And an evil man out of the evil treasure brings forth evil things. Here we go. Verse 36. But I say to you that for every idle word men may speak, they will give account of it in the day of judgment. For by your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned. Can you say amen? Listen, let me just capsulize this passage, this pericope, for one moment. If you and I say we're good, we say that we're sons and daughters of God, child of God, then what comes out of our mouth should bear that fruit. But there are some folk who say, that maybe they have good deeds, but they have bad words. Or they have good words and they have bad deeds. Brood of vipers. No, that's not how we get down. You got to be careful, because what comes out of your mouth, really, it speaks to the content of your heart. Okay? And you and I've got to understand that. That's why the Bible says, for out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. What's in your heart? Samuel L. Jackson, he says it this way on the commercial. He said, what's in your wallet? Here's what I have to ask the saints. What's in your heart? Are bad words in your heart? Hatred in your heart? Evil thoughts in your heart? being divisive, is that in your heart? Being a manipulator, is that in your heart? Being a liar, is that in your heart? I'm sure most of you will say, absolutely not, Pastor, that's not in my heart. So we have to be careful by the words that we speak. Because the scripture says, listen, you will be, listen, by your words you will be justified and by your words you will be condemned. Now, we understand when we confess Jesus as Lord in our lives and we become sons and daughters of God, absolutely. Listen, God saves us immediately. Now you and I have a responsibility to grow to become more like him every day. So we've got to let go of the past, let go of that, you know, old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. So we've got to take on that newness of life, newness in action, listen, and newness in words. So we've got to begin doing that. Your words are so important. Your words are so important. Proverbs 18 and 21 says that death and life come from them. Once again, the question on the table is, are your words bringing about more death or are they bringing about more life? Tonight, this is just a jump start to continue on in this series of asking the Lord, Lord, help me manage my mouth. But Lord, help me to see what's in my heart. If there's some things that are in my heart, God, help me to get rid of it. Help me not to have a lying tongue. Help me, Lord, not to have a divisive tongue. Let me not have a hasty tongue. But Lord, let me speak those things that are pleasant, those things that are lovely, those things that bring about glory to your name. Amen. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this time of sharing with your people. I thank you, dear Lord, that your word will not return unto you void, but it's going to accomplish everything that you set forth to accomplish in our lives. Now tonight, dear Lord, I pray and ask that you will forgive us. For Lord, many times we have spoken out of turn. We've been hasty in our words. We, God, have responded in the wrong manner. God, we have lied. We have exaggerated. We have told untruths and half-truths, God. God, for some, we've been, had divisive tongues. And I pray and ask tonight that you will please forgive. Forgive us, dear Lord. I pray that you will help us, God. Deliver us, Father, so that we will not have those same words come from our mouth, but give us the tongue of the wise. Help us to speak words that will encourage, words that will build, words that will heal. So I pray that tonight. I pray, Father, for those that have need to be delivered. God, delivered from using foul words, God, and using words that are words to cut down. Please, God, deliver from that tonight, I pray in the name of Jesus. Now, Father, I thank you, dear Lord, in your word, God, that you have let us know the power of our words. God, and tonight we confess and ask that you will forgive us. And we thank you, God, that you're God who not only hears, but you answer our prayers. So we bless your name. Now, Lord, there's so much more that we can pray tonight. I pray for those that are sick in their bodies. God, we speak a word of healing according to your word, dear God. Those, God, that are bound, those that need to be set free, we speak, God, a word of deliverance tonight in the name of Jesus. Those that need to be, God, just encouraged. God, we remind them that you never leave us, nor do you forsake us. You promise to be a very present help in the time of trouble. So, Lord, we just pray these and so many other blessings on your sons and daughters tonight. Meet them at their point of need. Now, Father, those that have lost loved ones, we continue to pray for them that you will comfort their heart, that you will strengthen them. Dear Lord, I just praise your name for being a God, Lord, that meets us at every one of our needs. Now, Father, there's so much more that we can pray tonight, but you know the needs that we have. So we just commit ourselves wholeheartedly to you, and we trust you. And we thank you, Father, for working things out on our behalf and helping us to speak words of life. And I thank you that we will see the fruit of it, God, by the words that we speak. So we love you tonight and we thank you for this time in Jesus Christ our Lord. Thank God. and amen and amen. All right, that is our lesson for tonight. I certainly hope and pray that you were blessed, that you were challenged. Can I tell you, this word speaks to all of us because we want to understand the power in our words. Amen. And when God has given us the power and the authority to speak words, you and I have a responsibility to tame this. Ask the Holy Spirit to help us and to guard our lips. Amen. All right. Now listen, our announcing clerk is going to come. But before our announcing clerk gives us our announcements and leads us in our time of giving, I want to let you know, if you've never given your life to Christ Jesus, there's going to be a number that appears right there on the screen. I need you to text that number. God loves you so very much that he sent Jesus to die for your sins and my sin. And you and I cannot have eternal life except it comes through Jesus Christ our Lord. Please, ma'am, please, sir, text that number. Maybe you say, listen, I'm already saved. I just have some prayer requests, some things I need someone to be in agreement with me on or to pray for me. Text that number. And we have great men and women of God who want to pray with you and pray for you. Amen. Praise God. Listen, as we're preparing our hearts to give, I want to thank you once again for your liberality as you have given. Man, down through the years, God has blessed this church. Thank you that you have helped us be a blessing to so many others. We've completed our sanctuary renovation, but can I tell you, we are embarking on the next big job, if you will, here at the church. We have a wonderful building in the George Godfrey Bailey building, and we're beginning the process of doing some work. Those of you who can and will, as you give your tithe and offering, and as you prepare to give, and you, even your building fund, you see that the resources are going to the edification of this house. I want you to be a blessing, those who can, to help us in this effort. We're actually starting to do a little bit of work now. Got to deal with some plumbing issues and moving forward as we are renovating and going to remodel that George Godfrey Bailey building. And I just want to thank you in advance for your liberality. So listen, that is my time for the day. And I just want to let you know that I love you with the love of the Lord. And there ain't one thing you could do about it. And if the Lord should tarry his coming and the creek don't rise, I look forward to seeing you this coming Sunday at 10 a.m. where we will be lifting up the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. In the meantime, stay safe and stay well. And we look forward to seeing you then. God bless.
There are four ways to give at SBC. We have made giving convenient, secure, and easy for you. Use these methods to give today.
Happy anniversary to Pastor Chris and Lady Heather. May God continue blessing your union. The Mission of Mercy's annual Thanksgiving food drive is November 26th from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. Happy anniversary to Raymond and Victoria Johnson, Larry and Deborah Hayes, Pastor Chris and Lady Heather Bourne, and Renee and Rolanda Granados. May God continue blessing your unions. If you take photos while you're at SBC, share them with us. Send them to 2bcmonroviaphotos@gmail.com. Pretty You presents a holiday wreath-making event on Saturday, November 23rd from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. The second annual Christmas Under the Stars Winter Festival is Saturday, December 7th from 1 p.m. to 5 p.m. If you are interested in driving the church van and have the proper qualifications, please contact Deacon Larry Hayes. Text the word member to 626-495-3020 to receive important church updates.
To get the latest copy of our Gazette, text Gazette to 626-495-3020. Please send your SBC pictures and videos to secondsnewsletter@gmail.com, or you can tag us in your social media post at 2BC Monrovia. SBC presents Heart for Health Patient Advocate, for an appointment with a health advocate who can assist you in getting the care you need to improve your health outcome. Contact Felicia Dixon at sbcheartforhealth@gmail.com. Corporate prayer night is every first Wednesday in person on the campus of SBC. Call the church office for the in-person schedule. The SBC nursery opens at 9:45 a.m. SBC's Children's Ministries Order of Service begins at 10 a.m. and ends at 11:30 a.m.
Please review the following Zoom ID information to be a part of Man Talk Monday or Women in Wisdom Monday.
Join us for Sunday school in person and virtually at 9 a.m. Visit our new website, sbcmonrovia.com. The SBC Pantry Ministry serves on Tuesdays from noon to 1 p.m. Prayer warriors are ready to pray for you and with you. Text the word PRAYER to 626-495-3020. SBC's Clothing Closet Ministry is requesting donations. You can donate on Sundays before and after service. Those are your announcements for the week. Be blessed.